Hello, dear ones. It's Alice. I'm of the stars. And I'm here with a question and a request for prayers for someone. There's just a question in my mind about this, and there may be some of you that know something about this topic because I'm pretty ignorant about it. So I'm asking, and I'm asking about this topic, and I'm also asking for prayers for this person. On the psychic plane, I've been hearing someone, a man who seems to be two people at once. And this person has one very mild-mannered personality, and then he seems to have like a very dark and evil voice that comes in and advises him to do acts of violence. And I don't know what to make of it, you know. I know in psychology there's this notion that sometimes people have multiple personalities, but to me it doesn't, you know, it seems to me equally plausible, because this soul has spoken in the past about a terrible childhood in which his father was had been accused by his community of killing a lot of people, and well, less than 10, but that's still quite a few, being probably a small community. And this, so the story on the like the deep subconscious plane for this person, this man, is that he is probably symbolic. Story is that his father was crucified, actually physically crucified, by the community for crimes like killing, those killings, and that his father asked him, the son, to make a fast end of him and kill him, and the son did that. And so that is like the symbolic story that is going on in this person's head with regard to his father. And there's yet another story about that he somehow, quote-unquote, slit his mother's throat when he left home. And I tend to think this is also symbolic, meaning that he asked her not to tell anybody about him, but it has that violent, like, feel to it, you know, that subconscious violent feel. And so I'm guessing that his parenting was not the usual sort of parenting. So what seems to be happening is that, like, when the urge comes to him to do something violent, and this other voice steps in and then, like, advises him on how to safely accomplish some act of murder or something like that. And so, and then I have one other thing that I can, and so it seems to me to be kind of an act of, parental, on the astral plane, maybe fatherly, obsession, I think they call it, or that the father's fractal or ghost or spirit is still wrapped around that young man, maybe because of the manner of death. And so since the father had like this unresolved soul trauma regarding violence, I think he may be actually advising the son to do the same thing. And so that's my alternate theory to the notion of multiple personalities in this instance. Because as it turns out, the young person, or relatively young person, when he accomplishes these acts of violence, theoretically it seems to me on the psychic plane, which is always rather, you know, loosely constructed as far as reality is concerned, but when in his mind he accomplishes these acts, he doesn't actually remember. It's as if this other personality, or this ghost of his father, or some other like the astral form of some other human person that's alive in the world, has actually stepped into his form and actually done that thing, and he himself has been someplace else. And then suddenly he finds himself back in his body, and, you know, with unexplained, like, signs of that something has happened, such as, like, blood on his shirt or something like that, something that he can't understand, some mental feeling of, like, excitement or arousal or some other thing that just doesn't make sense to him. So any thoughts y'all have on this? I have only one other lead, and mainly I think prayers are a good idea for people who are in this extreme predicament right now, because the light is so, so bright, you know. It's got to be difficult for them. It's got to be difficult. And for those of us that are sometimes, like, targeted, because very, very great, like, soul anguish and darkness tends to gravitate to people whose hearts are very open. So for the guides and the ascensioneers and people like us, the thing to do when this the attention, the dark attention is upon us, is to just open our hearts and clear our minds and open our hearts and know that all is well. It is well, it's just that it's clearing. So those are those two separate situations. And I was going to tell you the other thing about this person is he's apparently a married person. This is the way the story goes, astral plane stories, you know. He's apparently a married person, and I may have mentioned this in another video, that he within the last few weeks or the last month, he was about to, or thinking of having a sexual relations with his wife, and then apparently he suddenly just fainted and disappeared, and from wherever he was with her, and she was yelling, "What's going on? What's going on?" and saying that, and his spirit was like circling around my head, you know, it's like this, just as if he had just disappeared from that body, and yet into that body that is his body, swooped this very dark presence, and raped the wife, and she knew it wasn't him. She kept saying, "Stop, stop, stop!" Wow, what weird things are going on in the world today? I mean, what is that? What is going on? And so. Then after that act was accomplished, the presence that was around my head, it swooped back into its own body, and the other, whatever it was, swooped back out again, and the wife was saying, "Why did you do that? Why did you do that?" And the spirit was saying, like, "Nyar har har Vincent Price thing." It was going, "Because I could," you know. And I'm going, oh my gosh. So those are my thoughts, those are my questions, you know. If y'all know what to do about this, a fellow ascensioneers, just, I think, very good thoughts and prayers for these sorts of situations, and anything else you can think of, let me know. So there are just a couple of complications with regard to this scenario to do with the Glom effect that I've discussed in other blogs, and you could look that up under categories if you want, the Glom effect. One issue is that in the group that this person identifies with, there's another person, another man, that gets tagged by the same energy, whatever it is, which right now I'm going with the theory of the ghost father thing, which seems to be more prevalent in the world than we know, actually. It's very often that if parents die with soul wounding, that they'll, some portion of their consciousness will wrap itself around one or various of their children at various times too, because it's afraid and it's traumatized and it's confused and all that, and I think that's very common. So, but anyway, in this one scenario, which I think is the father, like, somehow they, you know, the father convincing the son towards a tendency towards violence, there's another person in the group that this that this person, this first person identifies with, who also gets tagged by whatever this influence is, this deep dark influence, to try to be convinced to do something violent. So I can hear both male voices, you know, at the same time flowing into the same like trend of thought and feeling. And that can be hard to figure out what is what. And in addition, there's a glom going on between this ghostly father figure that keeps coming in and keeps, or else a body elemental of like very strong proportions that was projected at the son before the father's death. It could be that. And but anyway, this voice comes in and seems to be very varied, which is why I tend towards the ghostly theory. And another complication is that the young person is confusing that voice with the voice of his own like spiritual counselor, who is also a father figure for him. So he thinks that the voice that he hears is his spiritual counselor telling him to do these things, when in fact it needs to be like sorted out and segregated from the energy of the spiritual counselor. You know what I mean? So there's a lesson in this for all of us, and that has to do with energy signatures, people's energy signatures. And so we all need to be able to learn how to identify instantly on the astral plane the energy signatures of the people that we looked up to, and distinguish these from the energy signatures that are dark or that are leading us in the out of the light and into darkness. So everybody has their own special soul signature or energy signature. So it's just a question of time and increasing awareness with the incoming light before we all finally figure all this out and are able to steer clear of the often subconscious or deeply unconscious influences toward darkness and steer ourselves, navigate ourselves upward to the light. So there's another theory that someone else mentioned to me just now on the psychic plane with regard to this business of imagining an act of violence that's, I forgot to mention, sexually arousing for the man involved. And that theory is, which seems also possible to me, that the man is having a daydream, like a subconscious or unconscious daydream of sexual violence, of violent sex. And so it may be very repressed because it's very socially unacceptable, if you get me. And it could be that this kind of violent sexual fantasy is shared or glommed onto by other men. So it could be one of the dark threads or dark undercurrents of the noosphere right now that's clearing. And this to me is a very happy possible solution to this story, this mystery, because if it is merely a daydream, it's not something that's being acted out. On the other hand, I would guess, or at least from Hindu theory about samskaras, that if the subconscious mind is popping up with these kinds of stories over and over again on a deep unconscious current of energy, then it increases the likelihood of these events being acted out in real life. So that's something else to consider, is, and I believe in the aphorisms of Patanjali, they suggest one of the first things in that book, How to Know God, has to do with changing these kinds of samskaras, these dark samskaras, first by repeating something positive, like the name of God, for instance, over and over again, so that it falls into the subconscious and becomes part of it and elevates the energies there. So that's something worth considering, I think, is a mantra or a prayer, a repeating prayer or chant or an affirmation. But the trick is to know that we're falling into these kinds of daydreams, if in fact they are daydreams. And one way to know that would be is if we have ever remembered, much to our chagrin, or perhaps even habitually falling into some kind of violent sexual action, then we will know that we have that undercurrent. And then if we wish to, we can use these positive thoughts to elevate our subconscious and transform it. So there's another thought about it. So I know I've come up with a number of different theories about what could be going on with regard to these repeating, like dreams of sexual violence. The first one was multiple personality, right? That's psychology. And then another one, went along to ghostly fractals of fathers, especially, who might be, if they were violently inclined, might be influencing their children, their sons, towards violence. And then I popped up with the idea that maybe if a father had a tendency to violence or had dreams of violence, that he might have projected energy in the form of a body elemental onto the sun, and that body elemental might be activating from time to time from some trigger that I don't know what that trigger is. Well, in the instance of the person that tracks me sometimes, one of the triggers is when I go off into the wilderness and start walking on a trail, and they get a kind of a hunter fury about them. And they start off with some like astral story with regard to hunting me and like that. And I just really, the way that I deal with that is I just look around me and I see how beautiful the day is, and I see how quiet the trail is. I hear the birds singing and the wind soughing in the trees, and I relate to that. I don't relate to what might be hidden in the soul wounding of the men of Earth right now. And so those are three, plus a digression, a personal digression. And the fourth was the daydreaming, right? The idea that men are glomming and daydreaming, socially unacceptable notions of violent sexuality. And there is one fifth thing that I could come up with regard to this. And I know you're not going to you'll probably say, this is not possible. But I'll relate to you first my experience, which some years ago I might or might not have mentioned to you. I think it was prior to my days of recording things on camcorder. So it was a long time ago. And I had gone down to an Episcopalian church in North Hollywood in the Los Angeles area because I had felt called to go down there at that time. That was a time right around the time of it was around the time of the shift, around 2011 or 2012, so not that long ago. And I had felt called to go down there. There was a strong calling at that time to go to various churches and to bring angelic presences to the churches, and Christ, actually the presence of Christ, to call in that as well. And I don't know why that was, you know, but when my soul calls me to do things, I try my best to accomplish them. And at that time, the callings were coming very, very fast to me to do this or to do that. So there's the setting. And what I did was I went, I'd never, or maybe a few times I had been there, a couple of times. It was far from where I lived. And it was a beautiful Anglican church. And it appealed to me because sometimes they spoke the service in Latin, I think. And they had this incredible organ, giant-sized, that, and a beautiful organ player. I mean, an amazing job. And so there were many reasons to be there. And in addition, those features of that church seemed to be very good for the angelic presences that wanted to come in. So here's what I did. I went down and I sat in the back, and it was a night service, and it was not the first time that I had done that. I sat in the back left side of the church, and the church was full of people. And I asked that the cherubim and the seraphim come in and be there to bless not just that church and all of the congregation, but also everyone in the Los Angeles area. And the response from the angelic realm was absolutely overwhelming. So I was like walking on air after the service ended, because I could still hear the angels singing, as it were, you know. The place was, that church was like angels everywhere. It was thick with the presence of angels. It was a wonderful experience, and I was so glad that I went there. So I started back to my car, which was parked in a parking lot the next block from the church. It was not the world's best area. It was not the world's worst area, and so I didn't know what to think. So I was on my guard, having had prior, many years ago, martial arts training, and training in keeping myself out of trouble, that kind of training. And so I sorry about this diamond light right about my third eye point. It doesn't seem to want to go away. And so I was walking very alert back to the car, and there was someone in front of me. It was a man with kind of fluffy blonde hair, you know, not an afro, but just, you know, very thick, fluffy blonde hair, and he was in front of me, and it seemed like he stiffened up as I was walking behind him, as if he didn't want me to be there, or as if he were angry, you know, his shoulders stiffened. And so I was even more on guard. And I heard someone coming behind me. It was dark, it was at night. I heard someone walking up behind me with a steady, slow step from the church to the parking lot. And it felt to me like that person was a protective presence, right? And the other person, the person that was in front of me, got close to his car, his vehicle, and then something happened to him. A presence, an energy descended on him. It was about 3 feet wide, circular around him, and about 9 feet tall. And that presence changed him in a way that became like violent. He had a violent intention suddenly, like rage and violence. And he turned slowly around with a fluid, liquid motion to face me. And this energy was that had come down upon him was still upon him. So I stood very still and very centered and connected to the ground, as I had learned in martial arts. And since I felt the presence of another being, a malevolent being, had descended on this person in front of me, I summoned the energy of Archangel Michael to me. And I felt the descent of its just as strong of an energy for the good all around me and above me. So what had happened there at that moment was a detente, a squaring off of perhaps what you'd say a fallen angel and the holy presence of Archangel Michael. Why that fallen angel should visit that one person. I think it was simply the thought that that person had of annoyance or anger or like that in that highly charged situation, having just exited the church with all the angels there and like that. Just some very slight turning to the negative in such a situation can summon something that we really don't want, an energy that we really don't want into our lives. We may have a thought of turning and of greeting in a flirtatious way, and it can be changed just like that to a thought of sexual violence. Yeah. And he sensed the other person coming, walking up behind me. He was about 15 feet behind me, and when he sensed that, the attention of the hold that this other energy had on him was broken, and he turned around and got into his own car. Okay, then I was safe to get into my car. Now, you wouldn't mention this, except it happened to me twice. It happened to me another time in that time frame, very close. I was walking in the mountains near my home at Sage Ranch, and I was walking at the time of when school children got off school. It was a little after 3 o'clock in the afternoon, because in the summertime, in the daytime, at Sage Ranch, it can get extremely hot. So I would wait until about 3, and then the children would be off school. And so this was some years ago, but it was such an incredible experience, not a good experience, but an interesting experience that I still remember it very vividly. I was in telepathic communication with the same person who had been at the church, or so it seemed. Who was not usually a malevolent person, more neutral than that, not malevolent typically, and or somebody else that said they were that person, or some other person, who knows, on the astral plane. And so I started to walk, and I noticed three young men, teenagers, one heavy built, muscular, and the other two slender, probably younger. They were standing on a rock in my way, right? On my way down my path. And there was this malevolent presence that first there was a message, a telepathic message that said, how did it go? I see the situation, and I will leave you now. And right, an energy of telepathic communication, like a telepathic channel of energy, or perhaps an axiatonal line-like connection between me and that other telepathic person, zinged back to that person, and that channel closed, right? And at the same time, that same kind of presence that I had seen before descending, descended on the person, the heavyset person in that group. And so I immediately turned and retraced my steps. All right. Now, I'm telling you this because I think that there are other energies that are possibilities with regard to sexual violence. And it seemed to me at that moment that there was a potential for sexual violence in that trio of young people because of the energy that descended on them, all right? And I have always translated that kind of energy as which we'd call demonic energy or lower astral plane energy or astral plane negative, those kinds of entities influencing a person somehow. So there's that also, that other possibility. I gave you the whole story so that you would know what happened to me, and you wouldn't like immediately say, hold it for nothing, you know. You wouldn't immediately dismiss this notion. So anyway, in those days, about these two anecdotes, those things were happening. There were tremendous firefights on Earth between the fallen angels and the angelic realm, or what you might call the demon world, and the angelic realm. It was breathtaking. It was incredible. And it's not like that now. It's more like this beautiful diamond light is here. This diamond light won't go away. It's still here. This beautiful diamond light is here for all humankind. And so. I love you all lots. Have fun with the light. Talk to y'all later. Take care. God bless you.